And we are going to get started. So we'll start with you, Kelly.
Okay, I guess I'll start then. Ani Kinawaya, Gamalsha Migazai Koi Indijinakaj, Wabijeshe Dodem, Chiging Nunji. So my name is Kelly Crawford. I'm from Chiging First Nation. And what should I just share? So I know I'm going to talk a little bit about the tree journey after, but just wanted to do some introductions. So I've been doing treaty education for a little while, and I'll explain a little bit more about that after Jody introduces herself. But I've been in education for a little bit. I've been a teacher, VP principal, and I'm currently the assistant director of Indigenous Initiatives at the University of Toronto. So this is one of the things we do for fun, treaty education resources. So I'll hand it over to Jody to introduce herself, and then we can get started.
Ani Kinawea. So my name is Jody, and I work in a couple of capacities. I work as my daytime job is the Indigenous Education Coordinator for District Dufferin-Peel Catholic District School Board. I don't know about anybody else, but my brain is really fried by the end of the day, so I'm going to struggle through this. The other capacity that I work in as a co-chair for a provincial organization called the First Nations Métis Inuit Education Association of Ontario. And we do lots of work in collaboration with things like what we're here presenting tonight. And what else can I tell you? My background is actually secondary education, although I've really had to get familiar with elementary in the role that I'm in now. And I guess more importantly than my my job is I'm a wife and a mom of five daughters and one granddaughter. And our claim to fame is that we live in a house with one bathroom. We pulled it off, raised our kids. They're all teenagers now, and we're still alive. So that's a little bit about me.
Perfect. Thank you. Okay. So, so welcome to everyone, for, joining us tonight and, or this afternoon. I don't even know what time it is, 4:30. The resource that we're going to be talking about is, do we bring up the slides there, Judy? Mm-hmm. We can kind of start there. So I'll tell you a little bit about just kind of the background. Working with the Anishinaabeg Nation, developing, treaty education resources, started, quite a while when Treaty Education Week was sort of recognized by the province of Ontario. We've been doing different resources yearly with that. So we had an elementary physical kit, a secondary physical kit, two books. And then it just so happened that there was, you know, this need to, bring voices and bring information in the online world, but it didn't, it was actually interesting because it wasn't because of COVID. It just, the timing had worked out very similar. So that was kind of ironic. So our session today is really going through sharing the resource with you. This is a secondary resource. The official launch for this resource is actually Treaty Week, which is the second week of November every year. So we're going to kind of take you through certain components of it and then ask you some questions, have some discussion to just get your thoughts about it. So that's basically that part of it. So with the resource, some of the things that we're showing you, there's some areas. So for example, the next slide that will be on the website. So there's a couple things there's two things that just need to be added for it to be complete. But we're going to show you this part, but it's actually not on the front page right now. But these are all of the different areas of learning. So who are the Anishinaabeg? Chinook Nagaywin, how we govern through our roles and responsibilities, relationships with land and water, broken promises, Robinson-Huron Treaty, Robinson-Huron Treaty Song, Treaty 3, Ipperwash, First Nation Building, United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, Land Back, and a Community Spotlight. So part of this work is really supporting teachers and having those, and I have to apologize, that is my dog Floyd, so I apologize for that right now. So the areas that we're going to be covering, we're not going to go through every section. We're going to highlight some section and share some of the videos for you. So do we want to
let's start with the trailer, because yes. It kind of sets the tone in terms of the learning that we want teachers and students to get out of this resource. So we'll play this for you.
My name is Josie Benson. After this ad. I'm a sixth grade science teacher in Central Illinois, and I've been using Generation Genius for an entire year.
The treaty process was one in which we agreed to share the use of all these lands.
Surrender and ceded have no basis in the Ojibwe language.
Most importantly, we did not surrender the lands.
So we never really relinquished any rights of our own to any government.
Our lands were never ceded and surrendered.
The land in what was then Kettle and Stony Point First Nations had been taken.
Okay, so and there was the in the chat asking about where to get the resource. So the resource, it's a free resource, and it's located on www.anishinaabeg.ca, and then you go to the education resources link, and then as you could see with the arrow on the bottom left, that's how you get to the resource.
So let's do that right now, so you can. Yeah. See what it looks like by going to the website. Okay, so here we are on the home page. So there up at the top, education resources, you're going to click on that. And you'll notice there's other resources listed here. So here is the elementary version if you are interested and want to take a peek at that. But this is where you'll click to get into the actual resource. So as Kelly mentioned, we're not going to go through every single page. We're going to just give you a high level overview, but we will go a little bit deeper in some of those sections. So on the front page here, these are all of the contributors. If you click on the play button here, You'll get to hear a little bit about each of the contributors so that you know who they are, where they come from, and a little bit about them. So I know as an educator and somebody who supports a school board, one of the biggest, often a question that's asked is when we talk about, when we talk about, what kind of maps do we teach about in schools? You know, we teach about Canada, we teach about the provinces, we teach about cities and towns, but we've completely in education erased Indigenous nations off the maps. And then we perpetuate that erasure through what gets presented in schools. So one of the biggest nations here is the Anishinaabeg Nation. And so, of course, following that, people are very curious to know a little bit more about who are the Anishinaabeg Nation. And so this section helps to provide that information. And again, this is laid out in such a way so that as an educator who may not know a whole lot about this content, it's structured in such a way that it helps you, it provides you the content. And then, you know, you can go along as a co-learner with your students in learning about this, but it's also designed in a way that it helps you as the educator present this in your classroom. So each section will have videos, downloadable PDFs, that you can use with guiding questions and a slide deck. So each component has a slide deck. You can download the slide deck here, but I'll just give you a quick snapshot. So again, it's very similar to what you just saw on the website. Each section has what are the main ideas or the big ideas being presented in this learning section. And so you can use this in your classroom as is with your students to help with that learning process. This is a really great video that helps to explain the Anishinaabeg Nation and the territory. And then just some more information. So that's kind of the layout that each section is going to look like. So we're going to dive into this one. Did you want to speak to this one, Kelly, or?
Okay, so Chinook-Nagaywin, how we govern through our roles and responsibilities. So can you just scroll down, Jody? So there's various videos here, and the one, what was the one that we were going to play?
We're going to talk about this one.
Okay. I just wanted to, I couldn't see that part. So really, you know, looking at the connections about what our natural laws are and how we are connected to land. And so why is this important, right? So the video that we're going to share with you is about climate change and colonialism. So what we'd like you to do is think about, how some questions that, you know, you might want to, some inquiry questions that you could take from this video. So we'll play that and then we'll have a discussion on that piece.
Being natural, that our people are what they are, you know, they're with nature, and we're not going to leave this world. We're always going to be here. We were here from day one for thousands of years before the coming of the white people, you know, or so-called immigrants that come here. See, right now we have a foreign system, a corporate world, the governments that are in place, thinking that they own us and all the land and the people in it. They're wrong. In a very short time, they've destroyed our lands, and look at how much sickness is floating around. we never had that years ago. Pagis mi negosyang, mi echip chip minisamang, what we were given, that's what we have to follow. It was a creator who set us in this land, and he gave us rules through the pipes, through the sweet grass and all these things that were given, along with the lodges and everything else that come along with it. Those are the things that we were given. But to pray and to give thanks for everything that we have, you know, because too often, Amunians come here, the white man come here. They start digging up the earth, they start planting things without putting a little tobacco in the ground. Okay, I'm going to do this, but please help me. We're not doing that. We're just take till we destroy everything.
Colonialism has its roots in resource extraction. Because colonies from different countries were formed here on Turtle Island, and their main objective was to get resources and bring them back, or to develop them here. And that's what colonization is. And so colonization was really instrumental in, of course, capitalism, the idea of capitalism. It was very instrumental in the global trading market. And all of it is dependent on what they take from the earth. And because of all of this resource extraction that happens in the name of colonialism, it's why we're in climate change. It's why we're suffering a massive ecological collapse. Because colonialism is deeply rooted and tied into resource extraction, into fossil fuel development, into mining, into deforestation, all of these things.
Well, we're going to get big floods here, and we're also, they just had a tornado on St. Louis Island. Or what does everybody call that tornado? That's what's doing that. They're raping the bush. They're not leaving the tall timbers for the rainforest.
Out there, this is where life is. The earth, the water, the trees. Trees is a fine example. Out in the prairies, they're getting all knocked down. But that's why we have so much climate change, because these trees are the lungs of the earth, and that's a lot of people don't realize that. Eh? And they mean a lot more than just beauty, of course, but all these things play hand in hand with everything that we go through in life.
And so Canada is like this huge colony that just keeps extracting and extracting and extracting, and it's causing a severe ecological collapse. It's causing our hydrology systems to fail. And so I think that it's important to understand how everybody is affected by colonization. I mean, everybody. It's all over the world. The globalization of Western education has done its job well in providing colonization into the deepest parts of the jungle, into the highest parts of the mountains and the Himalayas, you know, to the deepest parts of the outback in Australia, right into the very center of Africa. Colonization is just, it's a big thing. And, you know, we have to start, I think, detrenching away from that, because it's causing climate change. It's connected. Like, you cannot really talk about climate change and not talk about colonization when you're thinking about solutions.
Only way you can help this, everybody's got to get after the government in each town and stop giving out permits. They got to let the forest grow up so we can have the same kind of weather we had here 10 years ago.
But we have to try to get along so they can understand our way of life. We have to get back to the way we were, and that's why we're having so many problems today.
So we wanted to show you this video because maybe there might be some hesitation. Some people might be wondering, like, what's the purpose of treaty education? Like, why do we have to learn about this? And we kind of, and we brushed over the section here. We just pointed it out that it's here, but it's important to take time to really learn about, you know, we talk about worldview, to understand that there's a difference that has been going on these lands prior to contact, in that those values and beliefs and values have ensured the protection of lands and waters, and has enabled everyone to live a really beautiful, good, healthy life for millennia. And with, and coming into, and maybe you remember from the trailer that you just heard, you know, there was a calm and response. We did not surrender the land. Land was never to be ceded and surrendered. It was always about land sharing. Land sharing and agreeing to live in the, using these same beliefs and values. And so when we come to, you know, through treaty education, the hope is to start to make those bigger connections, those bigger, wider connections, and to see how this is all linked together and it impacts everybody. It doesn't matter where you're from or what your background is, we all need clean water to live. And so we have a great responsibility in education to really get students thinking about things differently, because we don't even know what the next 10, 15 years are gonna be like, because we're in such abrupt climate change. So I just wanna turn it now over to, into the chat. If we had asked you to think about what are some questions that, or inquiry prompts that you could see using in your classroom after watching a video like this. We'll just give it a minute for people to type in. Okay, so yeah, just having that discussion, putting up a statement on the board, colonialism is responsible for climate change. Okay, great. Yeah, having a discussion about what do you think colonialism is before, and then watching the video, and then having that discussion after, you know, maybe asking, has your any thoughts changed? Maybe we'll ask the group here, now that you've seen this video, has this changed any of your thinking, or has it perhaps drawn out more questions for you? Okay, these are really great prompts that are coming in. Kelly, did you want to say anything?
No, I'm just we can go through and give, there's some of them, like other one individual said that yes, that changed their view. Colonialism is often spoken in the past tense after watching this video discuss colonialism in the present tense.
Yeah,
a good one.
That's important. It's ongoing. It's currently living today.
How has the loss of an indigenous understanding of the land impacted the world, or our world? Okay, so in the resource, there is actually those areas to consider the following. So maybe what we should have done that in the beginning. You just got all of you guys to fill in those prompts. But so there's support there as well, as far as questions that can be inquiry questions that you can use in the resource. Did you want to scroll down a little further? Okay. And then as mentioned before, so just the supports with examples, and then of course the slide deck that you can use. So they're all, every section is set up in the same way.
So you'll see there's question prompts that go along with these videos as well, that kind of help to really explain that worldview and understanding. And really, you know, and it's important that we look back to ourselves and our students and think about, what are our roles and responsibilities? What are we, you know, how can we do better in terms of what was asked in those treaty agreements by coming to live on these lands? How are we actively protecting the lands and waters collectively together? So these are all things that, you know, everybody can take part of. And that was the ask, and that was the expectation of all of the treaty agreements that were taking place, right? Like, and it makes sense. You know, you go into somebody else's house, you would abide by those, you know, you would be respectful and you would but abide by the rules of those house, of that person's house that you're coming, even if you're coming to live permanently in somebody's house, you would abide by those rules. So it's the same thing as people come to live on these lands. Part of those responsibilities was to follow these, what we call natural laws. But it's really in that, and when you get into these videos, it really talks about the importance of reciprocity, giving back, not taking without giving something in return, taking time to be deeply grateful. Like, these are small things, but they're really, really important things. And they change how you view your environment and the lands and waters and all of creation when you're thinking in this different way, as opposed to just take, extract. That's the mindset that colonialism has put on all of us. And that's what we need to shift away from. So let's jump into, we're just going to skip over this one.
Broken promises.
Yep.
The next one.
But we'll just go in, we'll just show you. So there's a beautiful videos on our relationship with the land and water. They're also in VR. So you have the capacity to see them in VR. You can learn about, you can click on this and learn about all these incredible people. So again, we're going to watch this video. And again, the purpose of this resource is to help provide the content and the information that you as the educator may not feel confident or have all that information and knowledge. So, but when you play a video like this, hopefully you'll start to see that it's easy to make those connections into your classroom through the inquiry process. And like was mentioned, I'll just show you what this looks like just so you can see. When you click on that document, you can download this. And it actually is, you can type right into those fields. It's a, I don't know what it's called, but you can type right into them. So let's watch this movie or this video.
They put the highway through in 1887 or 88, 89. They put the railroad through. And there's letters right in there in the archives. This guy says, I can't do nothing with them bullheaded Indians. They don't want us to go through the land. Then the Indian agent sold 300,000 acres for 7 bags of flour and 14 blankets. So I said to them, what are you going to do? Cut them into quarter-inch strips and give everybody a chunk? and give everybody half a cup of flour? Is that the thing? Yeah. I hope people understand what I'm talking about. That was very crooked. They were crooked.
When treaties were signed, you know, there's different worldviews that were at play. You know, there's the settler society, the crown, indigenous peoples too, and it's a clash of worldviews. Now, the idea of land ownership is concepts that often don't exist within indigenous ideologies, worldview of owning land. You know, and often there's, in indigenous languages, there's no word, you know, to describe these concepts in English. So when the treaties were signed, there was two different interpretations around, you know, what this relationship would be, you know. So, and it's been heavily weighed on, you know, what the crown's or the government's interpretations are for the treaty. Indigenous peoples had a completely different understanding of what this relationship would be.
A treaty is something that you're supposed to follow to the rules that are set within, and you have to understand them. So for one thing, my grandfather could not read the writing that was on that document, so he was afraid to sign it because it would be giving something away. And so he chose not to. He said, I will not sign nothing. Because I might be giving everything away in the future if I sign something I don't understand, is what he said.
In order to steal land, you do two things. You conquer their god, and then you replace it with your god, and then you redefine the map. You redefine the boundaries, and you claim it to be yours. And really, more land has been stolen by maps than guns and bombs.
Shingok said to the Queen Elizabeth, Queen whatever her name was, or Victoria, he says, we're not selling to the water. That's our way of life, and we're keeping all our water. He went all over not to let the water go. Every reserve, and he traveled from after 1918, the war. He traveled there for pretty near, I guess, 14 years.
They had interpreters who did their best to translate the languages, but was at the time probably at most impossible to translate. Eh? They can only get close to, and that's why there's no real understanding of what took place in those days. And my grandfather's words were never recorded. You know, he said, I won't sign it, we'll just lend them. But they have to pay for the land use.
And so what happens is, of course, the crown, under the doctrine of discovery, started to call this place Canada. Canada became a country and started to call this place Canada under the doctrine of discovery. They didn't obtain this land legally. And so they started to make provinces, and they started to map out municipality areas and all sorts of parks and all sorts of things. And what happens is they teach children from when they're young all the way up until they're into university this map and the idea of it. And so people growing up believing that that's actually the truth, when in fact it is not. It's not the truth. The truth is the land was stolen. The map as we know it does not look like that in real life.
Now this guy went along, he put him in there cutting, sell the timber, and then he'd give the money to the guy, the land was his. They're cutting the reserve. I went to a meeting, chief asked me to go down. I told him that Duncan Township belongs to us. The guy that logged there, they called him Slippery Dan McDonald because he changed the line. The line, if you go up by Driving Lake, the old map I had, the half takes in half the...
Sorry, I don't know why it's saying that.
That's never happened to me, Jody. It's Marcy here. That's weird.
That's really strange. All right, maybe it'll go away.
Lake. Then he changed the line into the reserve. None of that lake is on the reserve now.
Did you know that in Belgium, they had a treaty to define what the boundaries of the United States and Canada are? And Indigenous people were not included. And we feel that that's an illegitimate border. How can they put a border on our lands without our consent? That's not right. But under the Doctrine of Discovery, you can conquer lands of people who are not Christians, enslave them or kill them, and you can mark that land as yours. And that's exactly what they did. And that's exactly what needs to change.
The islands weren't included, and the white people weren't smart enough to include them in the deal when they forged the treaty. So the islands, all the islands belong to all the tribes all over. St. Joe's Island, you know, the states claim that, but it belonged to the Garden River Band. And they traded it, and that was it. We just lost the island.
At what point did Indigenous peoples give up the right to manage their own territories? That's something that we never relinquished. And that's something that's understood in our communities and is exercised, you know, in many different ways.
But again, I will touch on my grandfather's understanding. Only allowing the immigrants to come in, that was the only thing that he understood at that table. There was no mention of resources, no mention of anything else. The only thing was, and that's what I talked about the Homesteaders Act. See, today, in the world that we live in, and I know everybody lives in towns, wherever they may, which they don't own. So they have to pay somebody. And if you don't pay that rent, you gotta get the hell out of there. So, when is our payment going to start in this country? And that's very important to understand that. And when did we give our rights away? We never gave them away. To date, yet we never gave them away.
You know, things have to change. I don't believe that the map as we see it now will be this way in the future. And this is a really good thing, because when Indigenous people start to are included in the maps, included in their territories, included in you know, the picture of what's being shown, then it shows that we're in solidarity and unity together. And that's always a good thing. We need to work together. And so by having us erased and kind of tucked away and hiding all of these things hasn't done any good. But exposing the truth, the truth is always the best. The way of the truth is the way of the future. Because when you tell the truth, good things happen. And good things will come out of it when the truth is told. And so I think that it'll be better because of that.
Okay, so maybe we'll just have a little bit of discussion in... You can use the chat box or however you want to do this. If maybe you have questions, perhaps this has changed your thinking. Perhaps it's brought forward some things that you didn't know about or hadn't heard about. And I did put in the chat box, you know, a thing about remember your sources, where you're getting information from. Part of a big reason for this resource to be put out is to provide you with primary source information directly from the people who are experiencing it. Be careful when you use the internet. be careful when you go to government sites. And maybe you can have that, you know, exploration in your classroom with students and think about, well, why might the government have a different interpretation of the treaties, you know, especially given now what you've heard.
Yeah, and also just to add to that, I was thinking that exact same thing, just about the bringing those voices into the classroom, because there's numerous people, you could put them in every classroom, you know, across the province. It would be a wonderful experience. However, one of the challenges is that really can't be done. So that was, you know, one of the purposes of the resource, to bring those voices to you. So I think too, another question that I'm curious about is, even after this video, do you think that would be useful for you and your students in the classroom?
Is there any questions from what you just heard that you're wondering about? We just basically told you in this video that Canada came about very illegally, was basically formed from land theft and genocide. Sometimes people are surprised to hear that. Yeah, I see in the chat box here, more land has been stolen by maps than wars. That's pretty powerful to think about that. And then how are we in education perpetuating a lie in terms of what this land looks like? No questions? Let's move along. So you'll see here, again, we've provided sample questions for you that you can download the fillable PDF. That's what I was looking for earlier, a fillable PDF. I think I was trying to search for those words. And these are basically, these questions here are what you see here. And so you can provide those with your students. And of course, you can come up with your own inquiry questions as well, depending on how you're going to pair it. I see some people in the chat box are talking about how they might use this in their English classroom or in other classroom spaces. So you might want to align it. There's another further exploration you can look at. And then there's down here additional videos for further learning, again, to keep building on those concepts. And again, like we mentioned, in all the sections is a slide deck that has everything that we just scrolled through is on the slide deck. So for example, in the class, like you might, if you're using the slide deck, the questions are, you can download them and share them out with your students, or you can, you know, put these, as you're projecting these in your classroom, you can have a discussion in your class all together. So a little bit about what that looks like. The next few sections, we don't have time to go into them, but just to point out what's here, some really big important treaties. I don't know, Kelly, if you want to really quickly
go through. Well, no, I don't think just we should real quick. Okay, so well, Robinson Huron Treaty. So videos here, just providing information on the Treaty of Niagara, on Robinson Huron Treaty, on and then further down it gets into the litigation that's happening with the Robinson Huron Treaty of 1850. So really, you know, an interesting, like when we do sessions and things with teachers, students. It's really important for people to realize, because there's just this, you know, this understanding that, like with the litigation, even that, it's just unbelievable the process that they've went through. And so it just provides that context, and also gives this the same thing, same format, with a fillable form. We also have like information about the court proceedings and how that's happening. And when you really think about it, as this goes forward, what does that mean for the rest of the treaties, right? Like what is this going to look like? And how is that going to get navigated? And then of course the slides. So it's everything set up this the similar way.
And hey, Marcy, just another thing to note on this video to fix the spelling here.
Yeah, I see that. I'm making notes as we go along. This is excellent. You know, when you look at something a million times and then you're, oh, look at that. I see it glaring right at me.
You know what? Since you're here, let's just pause for a minute. Do you want to just introduce yourself?
So good evening, everyone. My name is Marcy Becking. I'm the Director of Communications at the Anishinaabeg Nation. And I'm really happy to work with Jody and Kelly over a number of years now, I guess, Kelly especially. And so we're happy to provide these resources on the Anishinaabeg website for free. It's a work in progress. We're constantly updating, and we really appreciate your feedback. And I love the questions and comments in the chat. I'm taking screen grabs of everything. So I will fix things that you're noting. And miigwech for sharing with us today.
Miigwech, Marcy. Okay, so do we want to just go through and get to land back?
Yep. We'll just, this is a really cool one too. It has a beautiful animation to it and an explanation. And again, primary sources, right? So history has also been recorded. You know, maybe you've seen wampum belts and understand that history is recorded through wampum, but song is also another way of history being recorded. And that song has been passed down over the years. That speaks to that treaty as well from the Anishinaabeg side of things. This one dives into Treaty 3, same thing. There's questions and that you can learn about Treaty 3. This one dives into the Iberwash crisis, same format. A little bit about understanding what's going on today. Really important as well to take time to understand the what's called the UNDRIP, United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, because this is really setting out a framework to really understand and recognize that Indigenous peoples, you know, have separate rights, inherent rights that are different than Canadians. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that goes along with that and how that's connected into what's happening to today, especially with land claims, ensuring rights are protected and upheld. So lots of stuff in here, and there's like some activities that you can do with your students that are suggested in here. And now we're going to get into this one here, land back, which is always, this one it fascinates me because sometimes when we talk about land back, the response, people seem to think like we're coming for your home. It's a strange response, I find. That is not at all what land back means. There is like heaps of unoccupied land, plenty to go around. Nobody has to leave their homes. So I just wanted to point that out because it comes up all the time where people, that's the first thing they think of, you know, do I have to leave? Do I have to move? No. That's not what this is about. So we're going to play this video for you as well. Right, Kelly? Yes. Yep.
maybe somewhere on the news or newspapers, on social media, you're going to hear the terminology land back. And basically what that is Indigenous people returning back to their traditional territories, doing their traditional things. And so because many people, Indigenous people, don't believe that it's Crown land and that they never ceded and surrendered their lands, that they're able to go back home. And of course, live their lives, develop their sense of culture and traditions again, and rebuild who they are as a people. And that's a good thing. It's a very good thing.
Language and culture for Indigenous peoples is the foundation of who they are. So it's hard to separate one from the other. So when we understand how Indigenous people see the world, their relationship to it, to their family, their community, their nation, and the roles that they have to play in their community, it is super important.
So one thing that I really want to talk about is oftentimes when Indigenous people, go onto their traditional territories and protect their lands, they're often met with, police violence. And I mean militarized police violence. And this isn't right. Indigenous people have a right to protect their traditional lands because that's where they're from, that's where their people are buried, that's where they have their histories, that's where their languages come from. And like I said, there's more than enough land to go around. And there's no excuse for militarized police to get involved when Indigenous people are trying to protect the land during a climate crisis. And so we kind of need everybody's help on this to get on board and to say, no, this is not right. Why is it only Indigenous people that are met with militarized police when protecting the environment? There's something wrong with that. So racism, systemic racism, plays a role in this. And it's often the women that are being arrested, targeted, and thrown in jail for protecting plants, for protecting flowers and blueberries. It just doesn't make sense, and it needs to stop. And we need your help.
Just like language and culture, the land is essential. You can't differentiate, you can't separate them. The language is directly tied to the land. The way we understand the world, how education happens happens through the land. The relationship that we have to the land helps to identify the relationship that we have with ourselves, the relationship that we have with our families and our communities. The role that language and culture has in playing is rebuilding our family structures. It's rebuilding our communities, and it's helping to strengthen us as a nation of people.
Perfect. Okay, so excuse me. So as we go through here, those are where the stories are, right? Like as a variety of different stories and some reflecting questions, and then of course the the slides again. So
I'm gonna just click on this one, Kelly. So just as an additional, because the question was asked in the chat box as well. To kind of, what are some resources to support this conversation? So this link here will take you to a sway, and there's all kinds of things that you can learn about from different nations to really, like, especially, I don't know if you remember a few years ago with the blockades of the railway, why that was happening. If you remember, there was a whole big thing with the Mi'kmaq fisheries that was happening. This is all connected into treaties, treaty rights, the right to exist on your territories in the way you always have. And so this kind of helps unpack and discuss further. So if you want to dive into it a little bit more with your students, there's that resource there for you. And then the other big part of it too is really understanding when we look at systemic racism, policing is a huge one. You heard Isaac talking about that in the video, and even in this resource, you'll always see that as soon as Indigenous peoples are just simply trying to exist, like literally exist. You know, why it's always met with horrific police brutality and violence. And so you can, explore these with your students so that they can get a better understanding as to, you know, what is going on. And even maybe, you know, making that connection into, you know, how the RCMP, for example, was even started to begin with. Like the RCMP was created for the forced removal of Indigenous peoples off their homelands. And so it's still going on today. It's still a current issue. Like we said in the beginning, it's ongoing colonialism that is not over. It's still happening today. And then, so, you know, how could we have students come up with a solidarity action plan, right? Because we always want to have learning about, you know, because this content is, you know, talking about violence, genocide, stolen lands, like these are heavy topics to be talking about. And it's really important that we also keep equal time for students to see themselves as part of the solution, to see the possibilities of hope, to look for ways, how do we all work together to have a different outcome moving forward. So there's some suggestions on how to do that in here as well.
Okay, so then the last part is the community spotlight page, which I'm trying to be mindful of time. I know that Jody has some other pieces that she wants to share with you. But the question I'd like to ask now is, from what you've seen, and of course we welcome you to dive deep into it, but from what you've seen, do you see yourself using this resource, and what are your thoughts or any comments? I don't know if you want to add any other questions in there, Jody, but I think that's absolutely. Thank you, Rhonda. Definitely 100%. Great. We're getting lots of feedback. Great. Sharing with everyone. Well, we definitely really appreciate your feedback. And I think you're going to bring up the other slides, right? Because Jody also has something, a couple other things she wants to share.
I actually need to find it because it's not what I was thinking it was.
Oh.
Well, hold on one second. Any other questions? I'm surprised when people don't have questions. Surely there must be questions. This is a great time to ask them.
Yeah, we can, and we can also provide our, well, it's in the slides, providing our contact information. Are there resources for, I missed the last question, but I'll scroll back up in a second. Are there resources for Treaty Week, suggestions for school-wide involvement? Well, I would say like there are other, the elementary online is located in the same spot as well. So there's an elementary and a secondary. The other thing, like I mentioned, like this gets launched during Treaty Week. So it's and I always say too, like, even though we launch these things during Treaty Week, that it shouldn't be just the week. I often worry about that piece. And I just gotta, okay. How can we best ask questions once we dive deeper into the source? Like specifically about the resource, if that's what you mean, then you can definitely contact us.
So I found it.
Okay.
Okay. So I put the link in the chat box there. So just, this was something through, as I mentioned, I'm part of this organization. And this was created for educators, just some things to think about as you're preparing for Treaty Week. And again, like, remember how we started off, right? Treaties were for land sharing, for mutual benefit. Right now, there isn't mutual benefit. That's what we're trying to change. And that these are legally binding documents. That's why we have big issues right now with Canada, because Canada breaks its laws every single, its own laws every day with respect to the treaties. So these are these important conversations we got to know about. Couple of really fantastic books I highly recommend as well. These are links. So in this document, you can get these links as well. But I think every Canadian should read Unsettling Canada by Arthur Manuel, and then his follow-up book, The Reconciliation Manifesto. Really, really, really good for the adults, the educators, to have a better understanding. We gave you some real quick ones through the videos that we shared, but this kind of gives you a bit more in depth of understanding, like what's really going on. And again, remember we said center Indigenous voices, primary sources. So there's a bunch here as well of different videos. And again, be careful of the narrative that's being presented. Right now, like, again, think about the map, right? We just teach about Canada and the provinces. We don't even show treaty areas. We're not even considering or showing the other nations that have always existed and are still in existence today. And the evidence are the treaties themselves. That's the proof that the other nations still exist, because we have legal agreements. So just be careful. Again, you want to make sure you're using primary sourced vetted resources, and so hence this giant resource that's just been presented to you is pretty much like, that's exactly what you're wanting to bring in. And then again, how can you make connections to present day, right? So this is still all very much relevant to today, as we've talked about, it's ongoing. And so education and awareness, truth seeking, finding out the information, and then it's kind of like the so what, now what? Okay, let's think about what are we going to do about this? And then again, moving to action. So how do we get, students, especially secondary students, because that's the area that I come from, you know, they are just primed for speaking out against injustice. You know, when they learn about these truths, they have all kinds of brilliant ideas that they can bring forward. So, you know, just really turn it over to them when you're doing this learning in your classrooms, because they have so many creative, incredible solutions to be part of. So I just wanted to share that little piece for everyone. And oh, thank you. The link doesn't work. Okay, we'll have to update that link as well. But if you Google it, you'll find the book. And I'll just pop up our contact information. There we are. Working hard.
So there's our, there it is. There's the contact information. And so does anyone have any additional questions or comments?
Marcy?
Well, I'd like to know what's missing. So what, like what, as educators, are you looking for in the classroom? Like, what could we do next to help you reach out to your, engage with your students, to connect with them? So I'm very curious on what we can help out with in the next year or so.
Yeah, if any of it have anything you want to pop in the chat box right now, that would be great. Or you can unmute. You can always talk.
So I know that this is for secondary, but you did say, I was just wondering about, are the resources similar for elementary, or would an elementary teacher use these resources and kind of, you know, position them?
Yeah.
Can you bring the elementary up, Jody?
Yep. So I think depending on what grade in elementary, right? Like, because 7-8 kind of borders a little bit onto secondary. Is it?
Well, I guess I'm just thinking, I'm one of the schools I support is a K-8 school, So I'm just, I'm just thinking, and I've, you know, like, if I think about grade one, like if I go low end, forget grade eight for a moment. If I go low end, I was just thinking about starting where we're at, which is like, you know, the territory, right? Like the treaty, the land, right? And maybe that's as, you know, I want to say as basic for grade one. Like they're not, you know, at the point of going, you know, to a critical, you know, point in terms of, you know, well, actually, no, they might, climate change, and we think about, you know, but do you understand what I mean? Like, I'm wondering if there is, this seems very deep, and I'm just wondering, do we have resources where, same idea, different entry point?
Okay, so I can speak to that. So there is a whole elementary online resource as well, which stemmed from the physical kit, and that's what Jody's showing right now. And the one video there, maybe can we just play?
Hold on. Let me go back.
Just play
The original kit, and also like the We Are All Treaty People teachers kit, and also the Alex Shares His Wampum Belt and Dakota Talks About Treaties books.
Yeah, just play the Alex video so that
this one.
Yeah, just explains. Yeah.
Ani, Kinawea. Hello, everyone. It's me, Alex. I'm so happy that you are here going on this learning journey to better understand the importance of treaty education. I'm going to explain how this journey works. Let's get started. First, you will start here on this landing page. You will notice these different turtles. Each turtle represents a section of learning. Turtle 1 is who are the Anishinaabeg. Turtle 2 is what is a treaty. Turtle 3 is wampum. Turtle 4 is Gdoo-Sastamoo, the dish with one spoon. Turtle 5 is the Treaty of Niagara. Turtle 6 is the Robinson-Huron Treaty. Turtle 7 is the Anishinaabeg Hall of Heroes. And Turtle 8 is the last stop, bringing it all together. As you complete each section, you will notice on the right-hand side the wampum belt will begin to get colored in. Ready to get started? Let's go!
So the first three sections of this resource are really great for primary. And as you move through, the concepts kind of get, it's scaffolded in that way. So they build up through the grades, and they're done in animations as well. And they're, you know, it's created in a way that's meant for elementary kids, you know, so talking about what is a promise, you know, like the importance of what happens when you break a promise. Why is it important to make good promises? Like, so there's all kinds of that kind of language in that resource. So it's a little bit different than the secondary one.
Yeah, so I guess the answer is yes. And you can find it in the same location. And thank you for hopefully, Marcy, you're seeing those comments or in the chat, people suggesting what they could use, that type of thing.
I am capturing all of this great stuff. Thank you so much for your comment.
So I don't think there's any other questions. I don't think there is. Okay. So Miigwech for coming and coming to the session with us and for like your feedback and Marcy's got everything written down. So we'll see what the next journey is. And I wish you all well. And I'll pass it back to Jody for whatever comments she would like to make.
Just a chi Miigwech. And also, and thanks Marcy for being here.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Chi Miigwech for having me. We're so happy that it's also recorded. I think our team wanted to all be here. And definitely, I am so happy to see everyone involved. And the comments are just great. And the questions, everything's awesome. Thank you so much.
All right. Well, thanks everyone for tuning in. And we will see you when we see you next. Take good care, stay safe, and hopefully this will help you prepare for an incredible learning journey in this year's Treaty Week, which, as a reminder, first full week of November, not the first week, just the first full week of November is Treaties Recognition Week. Take good care, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye.